Thank you for having me here. This year I'm speaking, we won the Soft Power Cultural Organization Award. And unlike the mobile app, this is a much broader topic. So I'm going to kind of wander around a bit, and hopefully this all makes sense in the end. But we often refer to ourselves as a dialogue museum, and I'll kind of get into that. I'll set the stage first by saying, what is the Canadian Museum for Human Rights? Well, this was an idea museum born of a philanthropic concept that was sold to the federal government, and an act of parliament in 2008 made the project live. There was no legacy. It was literally an act of parliament. We didn't have a collection to build from. It was, you know, hire the staff, build the building, create the exhibitions, create your policy, process, procedure. You know, there was just literally no legacy. I started in September of 2009. I was a department of one. I'm now a division of five departments with 40 amazing collaborators and colleagues. But we had to do all of this stuff at the same time while figuring out exactly what a human rights museum was supposed to be. We opened our doors to the public in September of 2014, so we've been open for 3 years now. We had to consider, what is a human rights museum? So what is our subject? It's conceptual, it's an idea. It's a contemporary subject matter. The expression human rights wasn't even coined until the 1950s, so it's far from mature. It's very much still in flux. It's subject to interpretation. When you take a variable like race, culture, religion, geography, and you apply that variable to a concept of human rights, the interpretation can vary quite a bit. And we're active. We're not the Canadian Museum of Human Rights. We're the Canadian Museum for Human Rights, and that little word creates quite a difference and distinction when we're thinking about how we're going to operate museologically. So our mandate is to enhance understanding of human rights, promote respect, and to encourage reflection and dialogue. And it's really that end part, the encouragement of reflection and dialogue, that I consider when we're thinking about our collections mandate and our exhibitions of our collections. So the implications are twofold, in particular with collecting and exhibiting, as we want to be, like other museums, a trusted source of knowledge. So this is an image of The Keeper, which was an exhibition at the New Museum in New York that I saw last summer. It was absolutely phenomenal. And to me, it really visually embodied, you know, that classic idea of a museum built on a collection and the exhibition of that collection. And it's a trusted source of knowledge. So for us, the challenge was, how do we take this intangible, conceptual, contemporary, varied subject matter and figure out how we're going to collect that subject and exhibit that subject? And as much as I love this show, and it's one of my favorite shows ever, I knew that the shows we were working on were never going to be like this one. So intangible heritage. For us, that means we collect stories. We do have some 3D artifacts, but for us, really the artifact is the story. That means that we collect intangible, but it also means, in terms of exhibiting the intangible, that we use a real mixed and transmedia storytelling approach. So the implications for our collections is, as we've seen from some of the presentations over the last few days, human rights is largely an archival collection. For us, we do collect a lot of paper and documentation, but we really focus on more in digital and a digitization strategy. So we work with partners, we work with Library and Archives Canada, a lot of international partners as well, and we look at digitization and imaging. And the cornerstone of our collection is our oral history program. So that is really what we're curating, is we're curating stories. We're seeking out stories, and we're attempting to preserve Canadian heritage, world heritage, by capturing stories. This allows us to reduce redundancies with other national museums, so we're not vying for the same artifact that, say, the Canadian Museum of History or the Canadian War Museum is vying for. We're really looking for that oral history. So we've kind of carved out a niche for ourselves, and they're all part of Canada's collection, of which the national institutions are all stewards of. So this is a really kind of good fit for us. Some of the implications are that we do have 3D artifacts in our shows, but that means that we have a heavy rotation program. So that means our curators are constantly kept very busy, our loan officers, our registrar, as we move artifacts through our core exhibitions. We call them core exhibitions, not permanent exhibitions, because they're always changing. What this does, though, is gives us the opportunity to be dynamic. I mentioned that the subject is contemporary. It's always evolving and changing. And so by necessity, through our loan program, our core exhibitions have an opportunity to respond to the current discourse. Another sort of big implication in terms of exhibitions is, how do we tell difficult stories yet inspire? The last thing we wanted to be was, you know, a house of horrors. and we tell a lot of really difficult stories. When Malala Yousafzai contacted us and said, I really think my school uniform should be at the Canadian Museum for Human Rights, we were amazed, honored. And we worked on how we would present that. What would be the interpretive framework? We didn't want to portray her as a victim of the Taliban. We really wanted to talk about her as a girl of courage, as someone who stands up for education rights. So we have her artifact in display, but it's not used to demonstrate how she was a victim. It's used to demonstrate how she was not a bystander. She was an upstander, and how she can inspire others to do the same. This is an exhibition on Viola Desmond, which I'll get to in a second, but I have this sort of expression that I like to say, is that stories hold the power to inspire, and storytelling holds the power to engage. And, you know, we've all heard a speaker with a really important story who really just can't deliver the story very well. Hopefully I'm not that person today. We also have heard we have that friend who can, you know, walk down to get a slice of pizza, come back, and like it's the most riveting adventure of all time. So somehow I feel the challenge for my teams and I is how do we tell stories in a way that does justice to the stories that we're telling. So this is a story of Viola Desmond, and probably not many people know of her, not many Canadians knew of her until recently. Everyone kind of knows Rosa Parks' story. Well, 9 years before Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on the bus, Viola Desmond was arrested for sitting in the wrong section of a cinema in Halifax, Nova Scotia. And a lot of Canadians don't really know about this story. But we created this exhibit, and you know, in January, the new banknote is going to be released, the $10 banknote in Canada, and Sir John A. Macdonald is being replaced by Viola Desmond. And that's not because we created an exhibition, but we were part of the discourse that was happening. As Viola Desmond was becoming more known, so too were we contributing to that. And so one of the things we consider the Canadian Museum for Human Rights is how do our exhibitions play a role in contemporary discourse, and what's the role that we can play in collective memory? In terms of interaction design, the Dialogue Museum, many museums, I would say, the visitors go and are informed by the museum. I wanted us to be a really interactive museum. So the word interactive to me is not a synonym for digital. It doesn't mean pushing a button to read, watch, and listen, which are all passive activities. Interactive is reciprocal, it's dialogic. So in our museum, we want a museum where the museum informs the visitor, visitors inform the museum, visitors inform one another using the museum as a platform. And that's the approach that we take, whether we're hosting a public program, an educational program, creating an exhibition. When I think of our experience design, this is our Canadian Journeys Gallery. It's our largest of 11 core galleries. There's a diversity of stories around the perimeter, forced Japanese relocation, the history of women's rights in Canada, immigration and refugee stories, murdered and missing Indigenous women, labor rights in Canada, the history of the vote, same-sex marriage, et cetera, et cetera. So a real diversity of stories, but we also have a real diversity of experience design types. So we try to balance active, passive, interactive, and immersive experiences. If the experience is too passive, people will probably be bored at some point. If it's too active or too interactive, people will be tired. How do we balance the physical and cognitive journey that we're bringing people on while we're looking at a diversity of stories? So we really think about our experience design as we're presenting these installations and hopefully encouraging reflection and dialogue. So we really focus on mixed media. In this case, this is an exhibit on the War Measures Act. In 1970, Prime Minister Trudeau, first one, enacted the War Measures Act, which restricted the civil liberties of a number of Canadians. And then we were not in war. It's the only time in our history that the War Measures Act has been used while Canada was not at war. And what we do here is we have a documentary and a scenographic set. There's actually no artifacts in this installation other than the oral histories of this gentleman that we picked. But there's a monitor in the background, if you can see it, and that's the visitor who's being not recorded, but her image is being presented on that monitor through a camera in the set design. And the way it's set up is it looks like she's behind bars, and we're presenting questions over top that ask her to think about her civil liberties and how much of that she's willing to give up in order to feel safe. This is a way where the visitor is a variable in the experience that's being created. So a variety of stories, variety of storytelling, And that's what we're looking at to provoke engagement and better facilitate reflection and dialogue as we present exhibitions. I'm going to give a few examples here. This is an exhibition called Empowering Women that we loaned from the International Folk Art Museum in Santa Fe. Besides making the exhibition bilingual in English and in French, and meeting our inclusive design standards, it was a pretty one-dimensional show, but told really important stories. If you see that basket there, that's a basket that's made by a cooperative in Rwanda where Hutu and Tutsi women work together. It's a reconciliation activity. They actually sell the baskets. They get economic independence. They can afford to send their children to school. So one of the things we did was create tactile versions of all of the artifacts. Because we didn't want this to be a purely visual experience, we wanted to be a tactile experience as well. And then I sent three of my team to Guatemala. We recorded first-person testimony, post-war Guatemala, from women's cooperatives there, and we recorded that in 360-degree video and created a virtual reality experience. So this is the VR home screen. This is what it would look like if you didn't have a headset, but we have a 360 video version. Why did we do this? It was really important to, again, diversify the experience and try and hook and bring people into the content. So it wasn't just a textile show anymore. It wasn't just a show with things behind glass, people could touch stuff. But also, we can have people hear first-person testimony in an immersive environment. And what's important here is not that people came to a museum to wear a headset, but people came here to be immersed in the story and hear from the people directly, in juxtaposition of the two artifacts that are sitting right behind them in situ, which is the dress and the loom. So it wasn't about the VR, it wasn't about the dress and the loom, but it's about how those pieces work together in concert. I'm going to kind of skip this because I'm afraid I'll run out of time on this presentation. The witness blanket is an art piece that master carver Kerry Newman created for British Columbia. His father was a survivor of the residential school program in Canada. He went to the various residential school sites across the country, gathered found objects, and created this stunning piece. We really wanted to present this. This is a very powerful and emotional piece, very relevant today in Canada, but very passive. So we wanted to give people an opportunity to participate, to personalize their experience. So we created a reflection wall. The reflection wall is simply a digital interface. It's available both online and in the gallery. Visitors can type the reflection. The size of the words were based on how many times those words were used by different visitors. We allowed visitors to participate. We provided a platform for dialogue between the in situ and the remote visitors, whose both their comments were aggregated, and we presented this not only on the gallery wall, but online as well. This is an art piece called Trace. We commissioned Rebecca Belmore. She's a very well-known Canadian Indigenous artist, and we worked with her to represent the Indigenous heritage of the territory on which the museum is built. We did an archaeological survey before we opened. We found 40,000 artifact pieces of pots and arrowheads, etc. So we actually built the museum above the archaeological layer. It sits on caissons. And in order to represent that, we set up a workshop where the public could go and squeeze pieces of clay. Red clay is is what's in the territory on which the museum is built. And visitors were able to participate in the creation of this piece that then represents the territory on which we sit. So I think seven of those are mine. There's some 14,000 pieces in the work. But the dialogue that we got to have over the tables while people were squeezing the clay, and we didn't do this at the museum, we did this at a grocery store and community center in the north end of Winnipeg. But we had very rich dialogue, very rich discussion, and all of these people co-own this installation that appears in the gallery. I'm not going to talk too much about our inclusive design methodology because this is a whole presentation in itself, but just to say we have a very strict approach to inclusive design. And what does that mean? It means whether we're writing a policy, designing a website, creating an exhibition, working on something for the facilities, we think of all the vectors and factors of human diversity at the outset rather than try and come up with a great concept, execute it, and then figure out how to make it accessible or inclusive, and then end up compromising some aesthetic preference that we had or something. We think of our inclusivity at the very outset so that we have a more usable, wider range of offering for absolutely everybody. We have something called universal access points. We can look these up online, but it's basically how we make artifacts and cases, images and frames, text on the wall accessible to those people who can't see them or read it. We have a universal keypad. How does someone who's blind use a touchscreen or has a mobility impairment use a touchscreen or a tangible interface? We created a keypad. But it's not any of these individual sort of technological innovations that we've created that are the secret here. The secret is that we have a methodology that allows us to be inclusive, and the output of which is some of these things. We hosted an exhibition called Sight Unseen. It was created by guest curator. The curator was Douglas McCullough. This is a photography exhibition where all the photographs are contributed by blind photographers. So we put this into a human rights context and really challenged people on their perception of what is ability, what is disability. The irony of presenting a photography exhibition by blind photographers that blind people wouldn't be able to see was a little bit too much for my team and I, so we recreated the images in 3D tactile versions with hotspots that when they're touched would provide audio description. So for me, for example, I was able to see the photos not just with my eyes, but with my fingers and my ears. For the blind community, they came in and just absolutely felt so moved by this, because not only was the artwork from their community being represented, but they could actually experience the content. It was still very passive in terms of experience, though. So I was in a pub with two friends, one from South Carolina, one from Portland. My friend from South Carolina is blind. He's like, hold on, I gotta get a picture of you guys on Instagram. Pulls out his phone, takes a photo of us. We mocked him. It was a great photo. We actually found out how the native functions of his iOS worked, and we thought, how many people actually know about this? So as part of the exhibition, we created a station where we challenged our visitors to take photos sight unseen using voiceover functions on their phone. We aggregated all of those photos into a Tumblr page. We projected them on the wall in the gallery along with the rest of the exhibition, and we promoted it on social media. You didn't have to come into the exhibition to participate. You can do it, you know, irrespective of where you are. But we made the experience more inclusive through the tactile audio described photos, and we made it more participative through the activities. There's a British photographer who is featured in the exhibition, Rosita McKenzie. She doesn't see her photos, she's blind, until she passes them to an illustrator who does a simple line drawing of the photos, and using a special ink, then passes the page through a heater, and the heater raises the ink and makes an embossed version, and then Rosita gets to see exactly how she framed and took her photo. Someone on my team's like, how much do those heaters cost? $120? Excellent, let's put that in the gallery and give people an opportunity to do this themselves. So that's another thing that we've done. And when I think of, I guess, about soft power, trying to sum this up, I think of the museum's presence in Winnipeg. The University of Manitoba and the University of Winnipeg are the two universities in the city. They both have human rights programs now. Masters of Human Rights Law at University of Manitoba and the Global College at the University of Winnipeg. There's a new nonprofit organization called the Center of Human Rights Education. There's 14 different associations involved now in this. The National Center for Truth and Reconciliation was just designated its home in Winnipeg. Tourism, Winnipeg's not known for its tourism. Minus 37 degrees in the winter. Really sunny, but cold. It's a dry cold. Tourism has increased. This, just 2 weeks ago, we hosted, there's a national inquiry into murdered and missing Indigenous women in Canada. We hosted 3 days of hearings at the museum. We have collected over 220 oral histories today. We have a national student program in its pilot phase where we bring students from across the country to Winnipeg for 3 days of programs. They then become ambassadors and go back and continue the programs with their schools. Our school programs, our regular school programs, have been full since we opened. Human rights is in every curriculum. We do national public programs, so last week we hosted a conversation in Vancouver. Maybe I'll go to the events. Our booked years in advance, like wedding receptions, etc. The architecture of our building is amazing. But what's kind of interesting is, you know, weddings are like asking for tours of the exhibitions. How many weddings have you been to where you get like a curator talk on human rights issues? I don't know. Hey, in December, you know, I was at the International Association for Universal Design due to our inclusive design practice in Japan. I as presenting, you know, alongside Toyota. Like, I don't know what we're doing, but, you know, something. Our boutique stocks only direct and fair trade items. Winnipeg received a fair trade city designation this week. This is not all because of the museum, but this is about us participating in the discourse. We have 150 full-time employees now, 300 volunteers. We're maxed out on volunteers, there's a waiting list. And there's just a really high community ownership for the museum, which is a national museum. And I'm from Ottawa, where all the other national museums are, say Pier 21. There isn't that kind of local community ownership over a national product like there is at the Human Rights Museum. So I guess when I think of soft power, I think what we're doing is we're inclusive, and we're offering opportunities to be participatory and dialogic. And in terms of collections, we're trying to capture that dialogue and preserve it for future generations.